Hello, wild people. Welcome to AK Wild One. Today I'm at the site of the historic Kennecott Mine in Alaska. This mine ran between 1911 and 1938, and it occupies an important piece of Alaska history. I'm hiking one of the trails around here with Flash and Burn and our son Wesley. Today I'd like to talk to you about my thoughts and ruminations before we head out to complete our Pacific Crest Trail adventure. As you can see, right behind me is a lot of glacial moraine from Root Glacier, which I was on last episode. And I've seen pictures from 1911, nearly this same area, and the glacier basically covered it, obscured your vision of the mountains on the other side of it. That's how much it's melted in the last 110-15 years. So anyway, today we're going to talk about my thoughts and ruminations about our Pacific Crest Trail adventure this summer, and this will probably be the last episode until September. So I hope you'll tune in again. If you'd like to keep track of our trek, please, you can follow me on Facebook at AK Wild One. I'll post pictures, but I won't be vlogging along the trail. Okay, just a little history. The Kennecott Mine operated between 1911 and 1938. There was a 200-mile railroad that moved copper ore from Kennecott to present-day Cordova. And again, it brought in over $200 million. It was a tough place to be a worker. You worked long hours, 10, 12 hours a day. And you only got Christmas and the 4th of July off. We stayed near McCarthy, which is kind of known as Sin City. That's where the miners would go to drink and whoop it up, because none of that was permitted at Kennecott. We absolutely love coming to McCarthy. I think it allows me to tap into my inner hippie again. Lots of young people who work there as guides and in the little restaurants. And McCarthy's probably the most dog-friendly town you'll ever meet. Just this morning, as we walked into town, I don't know, three to five dogs greeted Burn. And she gets a little intense around other dogs. I think, you know, we adopted her from a musher, and Burn was a lead dog in the Iditarod. And so I think she's used to bossing other dogs around as a lead dog. And so she gets a little worked up, a little stressed out when she meets other dogs, but that's how it goes. So things are a little different this year. One thing is I think we're better trained. Last year we started out, you know, in March, and there was still a lot of snow in Alaska. This year, we're starting out later in July, and we've had a lot of uphill training. I think we've practiced good nutrition, hiked every day pretty much for the last 30 days. So our conditioning is, I think, top notch. So one part of our training that hasn't suffered is mosquito endurance training. This year, the mosquitoes have been shameless in Alaska. I think that's going to prepare us well for the mosquitoes in Oregon. We'll see how they compare. I'll let you know. Whew, it's a pretty steep hike. I'm sweating and getting a little tired, but I'll just take it slow. So as far as the whys go, I think the most important why is I look forward to reconnecting with my family, Flash, Burn, and our son, who's been away at college working on his PhD in mathematics. He does math that I can't even pronounce. He grew up, I dragged him along on every kind of trip imaginable, from rafting trips to fishing to hunting to backpacking to hiking to skiing to fat biking, those kind of things. So it's kind of a chance for us to reconnect over some past nostalgia, if you will. I also look forward to getting back into shape. I feel like I'm in okay shape, but not quite a weight trainer, a weight loss program like the PCT. So last year I lost 35 pounds and I put on about half of that. And I look forward to just shedding those pounds, being able to fit into the same size jeans that I did in high school. I know that's wishful thinking in the long run, but it's kind of a cool feeling, cool sensation when it happens. So I look forward to that. I also look forward to the serendipity of the trail, you know. Those beautiful sunrises, sunsets, the mornings after a storm, hailstorms, Crater Lake, the hidden waterfall, and the cool people that I always seem to meet along the way. I look forward to that. Last year I met some incredible young people and some older people who shared my passion, and I felt like I knew them my whole life. So I look forward to connecting with those kind of people too. Trail people, people who don't mind living ferally. I also look forward to finding inspiration on the trail. I hope I can come up with more interesting topics for my channel, more poems, and different ways of inspiring older hikers or people who might be disabled to get out and take the steps necessary to achieving their own peculiar grand adventure. As I mentioned before, that's really what I think this channel is about, deep down. You know, sometimes I feel like I live on borrowed time. You know, most people my age aren't doing this kind of stuff. And I don't know about you, but every week I hear of two or three people that I know who've come down with some kind of illness or affliction that changes their life. It kind of spooks me. So I have this desire to just keep going and going until, you know, that day of reckoning happens. And of course it will happen. I also look forward to completing the sequel to my documentary, A Pacific Crest Trail Cottywampal. And quite honestly, I don't have anything planned. I don't have a storyboard or anything, but usually ideas just kind of come to me on the trail, which is one of those great benefits of the trail, because I think you can find inspiration. And you know, I guess the underlying message in this next documentary will be the same. It's still the story of an old guy who kind of wishes to kick the Grim Reaper's butt just one more time, kick his butt down the road, you know, refuses to grow old and go quietly into the night. I guess that's kind of the common theme, right? So no mystery there. You know, and I guess that's part of one of my additional whys, is I wanted to leave behind a record for my kids. You know, the way I want them to remember me is someone who was passionate about adventure, who loved life, wasn't overly materialistic, you know, was spiritual, and just kept going for it. Somebody who didn't just give up as they got older. So creating a record that my kids can look at years after I'm gone means something to me. I'd like my kids to be able to look back on us and say, you know, my parents were really cool. They taught us how to live adventurously, how to work hard, how to keep our word. And probably more than anything, what would make me the most proud is if my kids said, you know, my parents, when they're in their 60s and maybe their 70s, man, they were badasses. Maybe that's not a bad epitaph. He done what he could. Man, was he a badass. I guess there's worse ways to be remembered. So, what's different this year about the PCT is my level of excitement's not the same. I know that sounds like a weird thing to say, but you know, we hiked 2,005 miles last year, and a lot of the excitement came from we didn't know what to expect of the experience. So, in order to keep a great attitude, I got to make sure I look forward to the serendipity. It's going to be a different year. Going to meet different people, different trail, different experiences. I've grown older. You know, we're taking a dog and our son. So things are going to be different. And so I just need to relish the unexpected. I look forward to connecting with you again in September. I hope you have a great summer. Hope you have lots of opportunities to get out and enjoy the wilderness. You know, if you'd like to keep track of our adventures, go ahead and follow me on Facebook, AK Wild One on Facebook. I'll be posting pictures and updates, but I'm going to save everything. I'm going to be taking videos and journaling, and so I'll save my bigger thoughts for the documentary. And so, my friends, I'm going to continue this hike today. And until we meet again, live wildly, my friends.